Greetings and salutations, viewers. Welcome to a new episode of Game Break. I am Charles, coming to you today with Planetarian, the Reverie of a Little Planet. I have no idea what to expect out of this one, other than that it's been in my queue for a little while now, and it looked cute at the time. So, let's dive right in, shall we? Let's see what we have here. A tale told by Key. Why don't you come to the planetarium? The beautiful twinkling of eternity that will never fade, no matter what. All the stars in the sky are waiting for you.
Planetarium wa ikaga desho?
The shit is this? That's weird. All the stars in the sky are waiting for you.
Planetarium wa ikaga desho?
Why don't you come to the planetarium? Are we going to have voice acting through all of this? Because that would be kind of cool. So long as there's the subtitles. Going to the planetarium when it's raining, though, a little anticlimactic. About 10,000 days later, how long did it take to get there? What the hell? What happened? Better late than never? Bloody hell, 10,000 days. Oh, and then not quite darkness.
Omedetou gozaimasu!
Hi. Both my eyes were shot through with light. It burns! I tore the night vision goggles off my face before they burned out my retinas. For several seconds, I wasn't able to do anything at all. However, the sound that assailed me next was neither the crack of machine gun fire, nor was it the hiss of nerve gas.
あなたはちょうど250万人目のお客様です。2,500,000th
customer? That's kind of cool. Young woman's voice, clear and sweet, completely out of the place in the midst of this godforsaken rubble. So, it's an AI? I pointed my grenade launcher forward, alarmed, even though I let the tension in my trigger finger drain away. I kept the weapon pointed straight ahead. After all, sometimes intimidation alone was enough. However, if that other person was trying to kill me... The hell did we walk into? The owner of that voice immediately fell silent.
申し訳ありません!本当に申し訳ありません!
Okay, so a pre-recorded message wouldn't do that. So it's at least somewhat sentient. So whoever this is...
本当は違うんです。お客様は本当はちょうど249万7,288番目のお客様なんです。2712番もごまかしてしまいました。
So it's an AI that lies?
ですが、きっと喜んでいただけると思ったんです。
I really had no idea what she was talking about. Waves of bewilderment swirled through my head. Why was there a human being in a place like this? And why a young woman at that? Was this a trap laid by another junker? But if that was the case, why was I still alive? On top of that, why was this girl not quitting her chattering?
実は今お伝えした数字も不正確なものなんです。 先頃、小さな男の子と小さな女の子の二人連れのお客様がいらっしゃった時、入館料のお持ち合わせがないということで、特例として無料で入館していただいたんです。ですから本当は、お客様はちょうど249,7290番目のお客様なんです。重ね重ね申し訳あり。
The figure of a person began to appear out of the light as the persistent after images oozed away. Oh, hey! You were in a little theater. It seemed like a short, young woman. That is the oddest bouquet I have ever seen. I took a close look at her as I continued to cautiously point the barrel of my gun towards her. She looked to be maybe 15 or 16 years old. Long, lightly colored hair, divided on both sides into ponytails. Strange earrings that almost totally concealed her ears. A hat sitting lightly on her head. Hair ornaments as wide as cargo bands. A short skirt that ended just above her knees. She was holding something in her arms, too. Couldn't imagine that it was a weapon, but its use as anything else was a complete mystery to me. This was simply an impossible scene. With an impossible girl? Her posture was more rigid and upright than even that of a toy soldier.
お客様?
The ceaseless chatter came to an end at last. She cocked her head slightly. There was a buzzing sound, almost like that of a leaf beetle in flight, along with her movement. Her long, unruly hair that was parted down the center suddenly billowed out even in the total absence of a breeze. It was almost as if her body was suspended in a sea of weightless silk threads. And at last, I understood. I understood what a defenseless little girl was doing in these uninhabited ruins. This being, who stood smiling like a fool before a man pointing a 40mm high-explosive grenade launcher at her, was... a robot?
Hi, robot desu.
A mind-reading robot?
当館解説員の星野夢美と申します。
星野夢美... Okay.
なんだそれは?
Oh hey, I have a voice too. That's awesome.
花束です.
Hey, I guessed right. It's a bouquet.
ご来館の記念にどうぞお受け取りください.
Why am I being gifted a bouquet of electronics? I looked at it once again. Fluorescent bulbs, old-style microphones, power cords, camera lenses, pieces of copper wire, fragments of organic plastic. The variegated bundle of junk was wrapped in a roll of opaque film, with ribbon cable tied in a bow at the bottom. I somehow got the impression that this situation was hopeless. Of course, I had never seen a bouquet of real flowers in my life, but it wasn't as if the obvious fact was lost on me. Those were absolutely not real flowers. They weren't even, for that matter, artificial flowers.
ご来館の記念にどうぞお受け取りください。
You already said that. I accepted her so-called bouquet. After I confirmed that there were no explosives or unusual artifacts in it, I threw it onto the floor. That's kind of rude.
申し訳ありません。実を申しますと、本物のお花が用意できなかったんです。本物のお花?
はい、お花は当デパート1階の青果売り場でお求めになれます。ご来店いただかなくても、お電話1本で迅速丁寧にお立ちいたします。でも、この頃、売り場まで電話が通じないんです。恥を忍んで申しますと、私は綺麗な花束というものを、正確には理解できないんです。本当に申し訳ありません。 Some knowledge of robots. Before the outbreak of the Great War, they comprised one of the prime export industries in the country that had once existed here. They were so exquisitely built that they could not be told apart from human beings with just a single glance. They thought of nothing but serving humans, and I abhorred and labored for the good of all mankind. Even so, there was something very odd about the way that this thing standing before my eyes was trying to appease me. Are you broken?
はい、少しだけ壊れています。現在、自己診断プログラムに未知のバグが存在します。バックアップ用電池が消耗しているので、交換が必要です。Wait,
if your backup battery is depleted, then what are you running
on? サポートセンターとの通信が確立できません。メンテナンスコールを送信していますが、受講されもパーソナルデータバックアップアーカイブに接続できません。頸椎部動力ユニットが摩耗しているので、
So, I presume cervical vertebral power unit is the primary one. Thankfully, still running, but. Huh. She reeled off her defects with more pride than an old man grown utterly tired of life.
それから、対人情報データベースと会話ルーチンに基地のバグが存在します。そのため、時間経過を考慮せず冗長な会話を繰り返してしまうのが。
At this point, I had already abandoned all hope of comprehending what she was saying. I looked around inside the room as I shouldered my grenade launcher. A dusky hemisphere-shaped roof dome. As I looked closely, I saw that there were uniform lines engraved over the entire surface. There didn't seem to be a single light installed anywhere. A large circular platform around 20 min diameter. Many plain chairs were closely packed in a radial configuration on that platform. Every single one faced the center of the room and was slightly reclined such that an occupant could look up comfortably. There were three doors, each one with a green, rectangular guidance light shining above it. I had no idea how this could be, but it meant that there was a private power generator on the premises, and that it was still operational. Judging from the cool dryness of the air, it appeared that the air conditioning was functional as well. There was a mechanism like none I had seen before at the center of this group of chairs. If I were to allow my imagination to run wild, I could very easily think that it was a gigantic double-headed black ant. Two spherical masses, each one with countless holes, were mounted like dumbbell weights on either side of a central shaft. A shaft tilted diagonally, supported by a steel scaffolding. The entire contraption stood in a delicate balance like that of a gyroscope. Two lights concealed by bowl-like covers, one on either side of the supports, were illuminating the entirety of the room. They were emitting a frail, harmless orange-colored light. Well, harmless only when it was not suddenly being shown into the eyes of someone wearing night vision goggles. The top of the ant's head came to about twice the height of a man. Had all the chairs been populated with people, it would seem almost as if those people were worshipping the ant. I'd only seen something like this once before in my life. It was in a place far colder than this. In a village that a few survivors of the final massacre had established, just inside the perimeter of the third line. The inhabitants of that village had fashioned a strange cylindrical idol out of the wreckage of battle mechs and placed it in a church with a shattered roof. They named it after a summer flower that had disappeared from this earth long ago. They'd dance in circles around that idol, praying to it in words I could not understand. They truly believed that if they did so, they could get the rain to stop falling. That helps put some of this into perspective.
お客様はちょうど29年と81日ぶりのお客様です。
How long ago was this war? If it's been almost 30 years since someone stopped by.
ようこそ花火師デパート本店屋上プラネタリウム館へ。
Rooftop Planetarium with the Flower Crest Department Store. What department store has its own planetarium? I want to go there. That'll be freaking awesome. Maybe not in that scenario, seeing as it seems to be very apocalyptic outside, but... This was a sarcophagus city. A dead zone, abandoned by its inhabitants after it was devastated by a bombardment of biochemical warheads filled with long half-life payloads during the early stages of the war. It was said that the direct causes of the war were global overpopulation and the failure of the space colonization project, combined with the total depletion of natural resources. Not that it mattered any longer. The Earth overflowed with foolish and selfish human beings back then, and the biggest fools among them pressed the buttons that caused the orbital satellites to fire their germ bomb warheads. Their intent was probably to lie in wait until the bombardment was over, and then to quietly seize control of everything afterwards. However, not a single person came back to re-inhabit these cities. All the inhabitants of the towns surrounding the germ-bombed cities had been vaporized in their mononuclear warhead strikes. 1 year after the outbreak of the war, Earth's human population had been cut in half. That number was halved again by the end of the second year, and halved again and again every following year. After the 10th year had passed, the countries that had begun the war no longer existed. But even then, the war did not end. People worked so hard to slaughter each other that even when there were no humans left to fight, they continued to airdrop autonomous battle mechs, collectively known as warmongers, in order to continue the bloodshed. Because the point of the war was no longer the conquest of land, it had become nothing other than the internecine creed of revenge and massacre. The world had become empty indeed, and the people who had the leisure to do such things as count the population vanished from the face of the earth. The purpose of life became merely to live, and so man began to produce nothing other than man. That situation dragged on for 20 long years. It was then when the rain began to fall. The rain continued to fall without regard for day or night, snatching away even the sunlight from this world and obliterating the seasons. It poisoned the soil and the water, withered the plants, cracked concrete, and turned steel into rusty garbage. Even the act of man giving birth to man would now come to naught, or so it seemed. There was nothing left in this world but dirt immersed in poison and unspeakable ruin. Well, that sucks. For a junker like me, a sarcophagus city was a mountain of treasure. Now, 30 years after the outbreak of the war, the artificial bacteria for which vaccines were never developed had all but died off. So it's been about 30 years since this great war that effectively killed mankind. How did people survive, even minimally? Even the vast sarcophagus dome that once enveloped the entirety of the city had been eroded away by the rain. However, the fact that people continued to avoid this area had not changed. When the inhabitants were ordered to evacuate, they left behind all their possessions and equipment, all the way down to their pins and needles. Thus, one could find MREs, various medicines, fuel, batteries, precision tools, weapons and ammunition, and all sorts of arcane devices in a more or less preserved state that could no longer be obtained these days in the usual air raid shelters and the destroyed military installations. And when one was very lucky indeed, one could find cases of pre-war distilled liquor and cigarettes. Because no matter what apocalypse you face, no matter how much war has ravaged the globe, it always seems to boil down to liquor, cigarettes or tobacco-based products, and coinage. Or, if you're going to go Fallout, caps, rather than actual coins. But liquor and cigarettes always seem to hold out in some way, shape, or form in apocalypses. Go figure. However, if you let your guard down for even a second, you'd quickly pay for trespassing many times over. This was guaranteed by the warmonger patrols, autonomous hedgehog hunter-killer tanks, and light anti-personnel Menschenjäger drones, all of them still in extermination mode, as well as the proximity mines that could be triggered even by opening doors. Not to mention the unstable floors and scaffoldings that could crumble just by stepping on them, the uncharacterizable fevers that seem to arise from an infection with mutant bacteria, the hordes of hungry rats, and other junkers who might be better armed. The list went on and on. The only way to do better is to plunder a sarcophagus city. I remembered an older junker telling me that once. That junker and I partnered up some time ago, and we worked together for about a year. My partner, whose chatter was annoying but skill as a junker couldn't be doubted, served the role of the scout, and I the role of the enforcer. As we shared a drink of pre-war J&B that we had discovered together one day, my partner informed me about the existence of a few sarcophagus cities located along an unplundered strip of the East Coast. He told me about the abundant riches and the untold dangers that lay therein.
But the most thing in that sarcophagus city has to be at the time when I met that robot.
I pressed for more details, but my partner said nothing more on the matter. Instead, he repeated himself by saying, "Do not talk to it. It's not a thing that is of this world." With a grimace that further distorted his face, whose nose had already been badly disfigured by some shrapnel from a fragmentation grenade. I think my partner said a few other things, but I couldn't remember what they were anymore. Eventually, that junker got ensnared by an obvious booby trap and died, too. His final words were, "A can of sardines from my hometown brings back memories." That's why I buried my erstwhile partner along with a can of the stuff after digging his grave. At the times, I wish that his last words had been a little less desolate and a little more stoic. Even now, I continue to wish that. Okay, so a ribbon does all sorts of fun stuff. That's adorable. The most irritating thing in this entire sarcophagus city showed off her functions to me with an exhaustive courtesy.
That's actually pretty cool.
Back in its prime, that probably made a lot of sense. She produced a card from the slot on her left ear like it was a magic trick.
Please, 換のプログラムです。
Where are we current programming guide? What current programming could there possibly be 30 years after the end of humanity? I took the preferred card, opened it, and took a glance. It was an antique made of ink and paper from 30 years ago. The small letters were so severely blurred that I could barely read them, and even then, the right margins were completely illegible. At the Flower Crest Rooftop Planetarium this month. Planetarium projection, the autumn stars and cons. Special feature, the reverie of mankind spreading. Note, we are expecting our 2,500,000th customer to...
無料ですので、遠慮なくお受け取りください。
I decided to ignore her instead, smiling the entire time. She cheerfully looked on as my fingers crumpled the card into a wad.
では次に、ホログラフィック録画再生機能をお見せします。
Oh my goodness.
お客様、当館にお越しになった記念に、ぜひ一言どうぞ。
What? Hey, let out a sigh as I was confronted by this unending monologue.I had lost my gloves, so my skin had been exposed to the open air for several days. My hands up to my wrists ached as if they had been pierced by needles, no thanks to the fact that I had been out in the rain for so long. There was a single cigarette left in the waterproof case in my breast pocket. It was the last of the pack I had bartered 2 dozen cluster fuel cells for at a trading post half a year ago.As soon as I took the case out, I was struck by a terrible feeling. Oh no, the front clasp was undone, and rusty brown drops of water were leaking out. Damn it. I involuntarily buried my head in my hands. And just like that, I looked up at the ceiling.Today's work had been a complete waste from the very outset. First, I fought with 3 other junkers over the right to use the only safe way into this godforsaken place. Although I somehow managed to win, I used up half my already meager supply of ammunition doing so. Then, after breaking through the quarantine wall, I ran into an entire platoon of messenjagers.Thanks to them, I ended up creeping, twisting, and turning inside a maze of rubble and mud for half a day. By the time I had caused 3 of them to run around and incapacitated the 4th, I had no more ammunition for my PDW, only 3 cartridges left for my grenade launcher, and I had totally lost my case of rations. As I surveyed the state of the city, my disappointment soared.The stores and the air raid shelters along the quarantine wall had already been broken into. There was nothing of value to be found in those places any longer. I should have been looking to escape right around that point. But instead, I proceeded deeper in. Beyond the gray curtain of rain, an old and somehow familiar-looking skyscraper stood erect against the wind, like some sort of magical tower.Using that building as a landmark, I penetrated into the very heart of the city. I still had some obstinacy in me and some impatience as well, but things like that were not what drove me forward. I was probably just sick and tired of everything. Of these miniature garden-like ruins with no one in them, of the rain that never stopped falling,of this ashen world that had been stripped of its natural order by the machinations of mankind. Oh dear, she's still here, while we're just ruminating and reminiscing. I raise my head, only to find her childlike face at point-blank range. She cocked her head uneasily, probably wondering why I hadn't replied to her yet.
もしかしてお体の具合がお命に関わるような容態なのでしょうか。私単体では対処できない事態です。とても。お客様、 デパートの医務室に連絡客様
お客様、黙れ。俺は客じゃないし病気でもない。
そうですか、お元気そうで何よりです。
Oh jeez. So it's a certain level of AI where, for better or worse, it doesn't necessarily have all of humanity's emotions.Kind of like Data before he got emotions. Or maybe Data's predecessor before. Because, you know, that's clever. That might actually be a better comparison.
以前に、投影中にお客様の具合が悪くなったことがありまして。それ以来、当館におきましては。
俺は客じゃないし、お前の話にもこの施設にも興味はない。
Hold on here. If there's a first aid response system,There's medical supplies. Medical supplies, so long as they actually hold out and don't expire, those are always useful. Those are always in need. Before we answer her and explain that the world's all gone to pot, we're going to have to wrap up this episode and see where things go next time round. I have no idea what we're in for, but it seems like the world has gone to hell in a handbasket, but we seem to be a junker on the search for treasures in a supposedly abandoned city, but if...Stuff has already been picked over. I don't know how much we're gonna find, or what we were expecting to find in a planetarium. I don't know if this AI is gonna be of any use to us. Would be nice, but I have a feeling it's going to be an interesting endeavor to get her to tell us anything useful. We'll find out next time. As always, thank you for joining me, and until next week, go be creative.Go play some video games. Go enjoy other people's stories. Go create some stories of your own and share them with others so we can all have some fun. And I will see you all next week.